So hello and welcome again. Microbehunter here, I'm Oliver, and today I want to share with you three outdated theories in biology. Now, these were once taken quite seriously. They were even taught as truth, but today we know that they really don't hold up very well, and some of them are actually almost forgotten. But in this video today, I want to bring them back to life, so to say, and you might now wonder, is this why even talk about them if they're no longer correct? Well, I think it's fascinating, not only from a historical perspective, but also old and wrong views about biology and about the world in general. All even wrong views help us understand better where our current knowledge about biology and on microorganisms or microorganisms, let me pronounce this correctly, on microbes, let's stay with that word. Basically, where our current knowledge about biology and microbes comes from. And now, if you stay until the end of this video, then I'll also want to share a quote with you from no one less than Sherlock Holmes, the famous detective, fictional character, but still he had something quite interesting to say, and I think he sums it up quite nicely. But let's get started. Now, the first outdated theory in biology is called vitalism, and yes, it's a very old theory. It goes back thousands of years to the Greek philosopher Aristotle. You get what I mean. And this view actually persisted all the way into the 19th century. People asked, what's the difference between a living and a non-living thing? And in other words, what makes something actually alive? Now, vitalism proposed that living beings had a special, force of life, a vital force that non-living things did not have. Now, scientists, of course, tried to find this force of life. They looked for it in heat, in magnetism, electricity even, things that could be measured by scientific methods. But all of their observations could be explained by physics and chemistry alone, and there was actually nothing unique to living things. Well, one famous example is Luigi Galvani, who studied frog legs, and when he touched the exposed nerves with metal instruments, his dissecting instruments, then the legs started to move and they twitched and they moved. Now, he thought that he discovered something called animal electricity, but what he did not know was that actually he created a battery by using his dissecting tools that were made of copper and of iron, and this caused the legs of the frog to contract, because this stimulated the nerves of the frog, and because those two metals created a small battery. So there was actually no vital force involved at all. So as hard as scientists looked for something unique in living things, they could not find it, and everything could be explained by, ultimately chemistry and also physics. Well, and to me, the problem actually runs even deeper. If you don't know what you're looking for exactly, then how do you even know when you've found it? Well, from a philosophical standpoint, scientific theories must be testable by experiment. And if living things were powered by a force which is beyond measurement, maybe something mystical or spiritual, then it would not be part of science at all, right? It wouldn't be accessible to scientific measurements, and then there is no point actually also in searching for it using scientific techniques. Well, I actually sometimes wonder if this is why vitalism stuck around for long. I mean, it sounded very profound, but it was actually never really testable. And of course, there was also no way to prove it wrong. Now, the second outdated theory that I want to talk about is called, another fancy term, pleomorphism. And I love those fancy terms, but this one is the idea that microorganisms could actually turn into different species. Now, in this view, bacteria could not only change their shape, but they could actually also become fungi. Now, that completely contradicts the views of modern biology. Now, the modern use of the word pleomorphism is different. Today, it simply describes microorganisms that can change their shape depending on environmental conditions. That is true, and this is also quite well documented. Some bacteria, for example, are able to form spores that look quite different from the viable form. But in its original sense, pleomorphism meant that organisms could transform themselves into entirely different species. And that's, of course, not possible because the DNA stays the same. We now know that. And, of course, a dog cannot become a cat. Bacteria cannot become fungi. Yeah, and fungi cannot also become, convert back to bacteria again. Now, the French chemist Antoine Béjean, he even took the whole idea of pleomorphism a step further. He proposed the existence of so-called microzymas. And these, he believed, were the fundamental units of life. According to him, and according to this view, these were were indestructible granules, those microzymes, which are present in all living things, and they're able to somehow survive even after the death of the organism. And it was these microzymes that he claimed that could transform into bacteria or fungi depending on the environment. So of course, I mean, this view is completely wrong. These microzymes do not exist. It's an invented idea without evidence. I personally consider it fascinating because it does hint towards a little bit this nature-nurture debate. Is the environment able to influence the development of organisms? But I think that's again a totally different story. Now, these days, the idea of pleomorphism still appears in some alternative medicine circles, but actually it's a theory that's completely outdated. Pleomorphism in its original sense is not part of the scientific consensus. It was none other than the famous Robert Koch, a German biologist and doctor, who demonstrated that each specific disease is caused by one specific bacterium. The bacterium that causes tuberculosis, for example, which is an infection of the lungs, is not going to suddenly transform into one that causes cholera, which basically is a completely different disease. Now, for anyone with a basic understanding of biology these days, I mean, this seems so obvious nowadays. But back in the day, the things were not quite as clear. Now, the last theory that hasn't aged well is called spontaneous generation. It was the idea that living things, not just microorganisms, but even animals, like flies, right? They could appear out of non-living material. You know, so for example, if you left a sandwich or some other food out for a few days, it would start to grow mold and bacteria would be over it. And people believe that these organisms came directly from the sandwich itself, from the food itself. Now, of course, we now know it's not true. The food simply got contaminated by microbes from the air, which then settled on the food, and they started to use this food as nutrient sources, and then they started to multiply and grow. But until the 19th century, the belief was that basically they could just appear spontaneously. Now, it took the work of Louis Pasteur in the 19th century to prove conclusively that spontaneous generation does not occur. His swan-necked flask experiments showed that if bacteria were prevented from entering in nutrient broth, some kind of a nutrient soup, then if they cannot enter this soup, then no life is able to appear on its own. But I think a more modern example makes this quite clear. For example, take a sealed tin can, for example. Why is it able to preserve food? Well, it's not because there is no air inside. It's because there are no bacteria inside. After sealing the can was heated to kill any microbes that might be present. And it's this basically what Louis Pasteur demonstrated with his experiments. Once the food is sterile, then bacteria and fungi cannot simply appear on their own to spoil it. So he kind of settled the dispute once and for all. Spontaneous generation does not happen, and life can only come from a pre-existing life. Now, I'm of course well aware that this begs another question, because if this is the case, that living things can only come from pre-existing living things, where did the first cells come from, right? Yeah, it's a chicken and egg problem. But that's an entirely different story, so don't get me started on that one, because that's a long story. Now, vitalism, pleomorphism, microzymes, spontaneous generation. So all of these ideas and concepts basically were created by people in order to explain natural phenomena that they could not explain otherwise. So you might call them, I don't know, maybe placeholder concepts. Now, and as we gained more knowledge in biology, these ideas became obsolete or kind of replaced by other theories. So science is able to self-correct, and that's a very important strength of science. But I think that one still has to be a little bit careful here. I think it can be problematic if one first invents concepts and theories and then looks for evidence that support it. You invent the idea of vitalism, for example, and then you kind of try to find evidence for it. Now, that's not the way that it should be. It should be the other way around. First you have the evidence, first you have the data, and then you try to formulate a theory based on that evidence. Essentially, I also think that sometimes it's okay to say, well, I just don't know. I don't have enough data yet to form a conclusion. And now to the quote from Sherlock Holmes. It's a famous detective of the 19th century of the Victorian age. Now, he's a fictional character, of course. But I think the quote still is quite remarkable, and we can learn from it quite a bit. And he said the following: I have no data yet. It's a capital mistake to theorize before one has data. Insensibly, one begins to twist the facts to suit theories instead of theories to suit facts. Yeah, that's basically what he said. First the data, then the theory. Yeah, and I think they should have listened to him. For me, that's all I want to share with you today. I wish you all the best. Happy microbe hunting as always, and hope to see you again in the next video. Bye-bye.